So, you know, Dhanpal, this food is a big theme for Everstone, right? So I'm trying to focus less on valuation and, you know, all of those kind of things, guys. Let's talk about, you know, what are the big trends in food, right? What kind of companies are being funded? What kind of exits do you know, late stage funds like Everstone, Ambit, and even Sequoia doing late stage investments now? And what kind of people they're funding, right? So Dhanpal, food is a big theme, like is it a very big part of your fund?
Yes, I think if you
broadly look at food, we actually tend to define it everything from farm to fork. And so it kind of goes to the very basic level of food security, which we talk about as a nation as a whole. And today, given that there are 6 billion people and more mouths to feed as we keep going, it's a fundamental issue. So how do you produce more food as a, you know, globally and as a nation? And coming down absolutely the last mile as to the food on your plate, so what do you eat and how do you basically go about, you know, figuring out what's the right construct in which to deliver it. So there are lots and lots of slices across the space, and what is interesting to note is we had 5 business models over here, and each of the 5, what do we call these?
Open
startup pitches, right? Open pitches.
Startup,
yeah.
Yes.
Each of these 5 was quite different from the other, right? It just shows the diversity or the broadness or the breadth of the entire sector has, and it also shows the depth that one doesn't necessarily need to only talk about the end consumer, but there are lots and lots of business models which need to come into place to service, say for example, the QSR industry, to service large food processing companies, to service consumers who basically trying to figure out as to what they want to eat and what they want to buy, etc. So I just believe that the space overall, it's almost like roti kapda makan, right? We were talking about it's an integral part of the consumer's wallet. I believe it's an increasing part of the consumer's wallet. And how does one create a business model to actually make money out of it? So within that, we've actually looked at agrichemical companies, which are basically farm input businesses, farm output companies, which do agri logistics. We've looked at food services companies, food retail companies, packaged food companies. So they're all types of kind of models that we have supported and serviced, invested in.
So, Vivek, you know, you have done a few packaged foods companies, and that's a very tough space. You know, lots of large FMCG companies, including Pepsi, ITC, big guys in that space, right? How do you see that space, and in general, you know, why packaged goods? And why not, for example, other options available in food?
So, you know, I think packaged goods is just one of the spaces, but you know, we look at food fundamentally from a 2x2 matrix. So there is a product, a service, and there is a B2B and a B2C. So in all 4 quadrants, India is just about starting. So let me give a simple example. So, you know, as you said, packaged goods, a B2C biscuit company. You know, so it's a consumer brand, you know, a biscuit company. But they can be a B2B, you know, equivalent flour company, which makes flour and supplies to various companies. And the same thing applies to a service industry. So you could be a distributor of food to hotels. It's a B2B service company. And then a B2C service company, which we heard, you know, so many of them just now. So in India, we believe that the B2C space is just about starting to, you know, become active. The B2B hasn't even started.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, there is so much action and happening, and great to see stuff. You know, full house, that we believe every of these 4 quadrants is going to be full with, you know, hundreds of entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. And opportunities lie everywhere. So packaged food is just, you know, maybe right now,
right.
But there are options across.
Correct. So VT, Sequoia is like, you know, globally is a really cutting edge tech fund. But in India, you have a significant exposure to food and derivatives, right? So what's driving that thinking? You know, is food the only place where you're going so deep into non-tech spaces, or is this like a theme for India? Why what is special about food?
So look, I think in both India and China, given that Sequoia started much later from an evolution perspective, but these economies are still early from an evolution perspective, we have been pretty focused on consumer and healthcare, I would say, in a very broad brush. And to what Dhanpal was saying, therefore, for us, consumer food in its entirety, the way many people on the panel have already articulated, starting from ingredients to packaged foods to food services to elements around food services which may be technology enabled in some cases, may not be technology enabled in the other cases. And then apparel, and you know, the whole host of consumption has been a very, very significant part of our theme in both India and China. And as we look at China again and again, the one thing that we learn is, especially in food, the extent and magnitude of underdevelopment in India is far more. It's just very early days, even from unbranded to branded, very early days in terms of eating out. So it's, everything is early. So I think the trick is in figuring out amongst the many early things which one will pick up steam faster and grow bigger. And that has been reflected in how we have thought about investments. But it's been pretty holistic, right? I'm saying we, you know, we see Zomato as a food company because it's really food discovery. The only thing is food discovery for people who are eating out as opposed to buying products up from outside. We have an investment in a company called Yellow Diamond, which is again snacks. So it's hardcore packaged food sold through a sales distribution network. But we see it all as really one thing. And I think for us, the trick is, you know, it's case by case looking at how that particular model looks like and what, how quickly we think we can scale that today versus what could happen.
Of course. So, Vinit, what's your experience with food and you can tell us about what Matrix has been doing in the food space?
Yeah. So we invested us quite a few years back in China. So that's been the only food investment that we made in traditional food businesses. Recently we've done a food tech investment in a seed stage company which is offering tech solutions to restaurants, starting from POS solutions to all different types of solutions. But the way we are looking at again, you know, different views on the opportunity in terms of whether it is products or services, B2B or B2C, so we are very bullish that at the end of the day, food is the largest consumption bucket in the Indian economy, right? So there has to be great businesses created in each of these buckets as you described. And for us, it's just a question of finding the right fit of entrepreneur and business model innovation in any of these.
So one thing I'm going to talk about is brands, how all of you view brands and, you know, what kind of characteristics you look at in brands. You know, we all know that, you know, for an institutional investor to invest in, it has to be a very large play. So, you know, VTU invested in this company called Hector Beverages. Not necessarily a very large space, you know. Now, of course, they're doing well. So how did you evaluate it? I mean, did you think that this is the market is going to grow? What was the thinking behind Hector?
It's a very interesting question, and it's still early days, as they always say. So it's always too early to celebrate. But I think for us, what was interesting there was an entrepreneur who was very motivated by the idea that you can make Indian ethnic beverages cool, contemporary, modern, relevant. Did we all know of these beverages? Absolutely. I'm sure each one of us has grown up having, you know, either an Amrus or a Jaljeera or a Kokum, or, you know, every state in India probably has some drink which you drank when it was hot, when it was summer, and your grandmother or maybe your mother had the skill to make it and give it. And for certainly now, neither you nor your wife has the skill to make it. So I think the knowledge existed. I think what was clear was also that the way to tap the market, historically, many of the approach that people have taken is, they'll come up with a Jaljeera product, you know, but, you know, really old style packaging, very value, catering, trying to cater to a very old customer who knew about Jaljeera, but really not bothering about saying, can I make it relevant, contemporary, cool? And why should it not be? And then you step back and ask yourself the question, which I think here, in all honesty, the full credit goes to the entrepreneur for making us really ask the question, saying, I'm saying, if Coke can sell whatever, sugared, carbonated beverage, I'm saying, why can't you sell a product which is probably more healthy, is probably more tasty, and certainly rooted, but as long as you make it relevant. So I think the, what we liked about here was, you know, it's a point Rajat made. One is, of course, the concept that Indian ethnic drinks can and should have a large market, but the way he approached it, which is to say, I'll make it cool, I'll make it premium, I'll make it contemporary, and then I'll make it relevant for a very big part of the opinion shaping a segment, and once these people have it, you know, then everyone will have it. So I think that was what was intriguing, and that was what made it very interesting.
I think their pricing is also very competitive. For
it is actually more expensive.
It is expensive. It's not.
It's actually more expensive. So typical price range here, you know, would be 20. It actually goes from 15 to 25. they have a their pricing starts at 30.
Yeah.
30. So it's actually extremely expensive, and therefore it's in fact that was a big, as you can imagine, a big debate.
Unless
internally.
You just can't hold it back.
So
yeah.
Expensive.
You have to make
I'm representing Paperboard and Thing I Invest. So I understand very well what you're saying. My personal understanding is Mr. Neeraj has got a background of Coca-Cola and he had a fantastic setup of network of distribution.
Yeah.
That business acumen and knowing the sense of penetrating the existing beverage market was the winner for the success apart from the two lines
of
Indian.
Oh, absolutely. And we'll go to that, you know, I mean, what kind of people are being funded. No, absolutely.
Yeah.
So, David, what kind of brands have you funded and what have you seen? How do you evaluate a brand when you want to invest in?
So, you know, I think one of the themes for us comes from that since all the four quadrants, need to be filled, there is a lot of, but we still, you know, billions of people consume food, so it's all being consumed primarily in the raw or unorganized format. The biggest factory in food in India is the kitchen. So we believe that slowly from the kitchen is going to move into an aisle. And therefore, what is it that we move from the kitchen to the aisle faster or is already happening? Has it moved from the kitchen to, let's say, a small mom and pop shop in an unhygienic form? And then from there, can it move to a packaged form into a shop? Those things, you know, matter to us a lot, because if you're to grow fast, you may not want to be there trying to sell a concept which is alien to the consumers. You want to sell a concept which they already know. You know, as we were sharing that we know about the jaljeeras and the ampannas, but just that we never had an opportunity to consume it in a hygienic, nice, cool format. So for us, well, that's one of the underlying theme for most of our investments or potential investments.
So, Temple, you know, now everybody's talking about health brands and all of that, right? I mean, that's the new thing. And while all of this is going on, Everstone, you know, gets in Burger King.
Let's take a poll as to who doesn't want Burger King.
Yeah. So, you know.
Guys, you got to side with me, huh? Make sure hands up.
So, how many of you think Burger King is good for health?
Who said you only eat to be healthy? Yeah. Yeah?
So,
if that was the case, life would be very boring. Yeah,
so,
right?
You know, but Denpa, McDonald's has been around for years now, and you think there is room for more people like Burger King, and will it be like again, trying to do a more healthy twist, or will it be like a classic Burger King that they have in the US?
Okay, I think it's a little bit also about questioning is, do we just ape what's there in the other markets, or do we make a product relevant to your consumer, right? And I think it's a lot about making the product a lot more relevant to the consumer. So I think the fundamental issue about what we have learned about food in India is that while people believe that there is a lot of localization, in some senses, you also are changing customer tastes and customer preferences.
Okay,
so while you are adding local twists to it, it's not just about trying to repackage something which you're used to,
mm-hmm.
and basically just trying to deliver that. So I think people are getting more experimental,
mm-hmm.
in terms of the kind of cuisine that they need to live with. And in many ways, we've seen that work very successfully in Chinese formats.
Mm.
We've seen it work very successfully in Italian formats, where if you really look at it, they're no longer Chinese. You go to Chinese place in India, you're not really eating Chinese food.
Yeah.
It's Indian, you know, I would say, tasting food, which is in a Chinese kind of a look and feel. So I think anything that you get into India in the food business, you have to keep that in mind.
Right.
The second thing, it's really the question, and it's about a changing audience also, right? Today, 10 years ago, people ate out only as an occasion-based, I would say, expense. Today, that decision is more convenience-based. It's more, in some ways, functional. In some ways, it's kind of almost become a right of way. People want to go and eat out because they just feel it's the right thing to do, and it's better to do it than to try and go through the hassles of basically cooking something at home.
Rising salaries of the maids, right? Better off just eating out.
You know, between LPG cylinder cost rising
expensive to cook at home.
Exactly. At some point in time, scale benefits are going to kick in.
Yeah.
And something in a restaurant, if it's served in a hygienic, healthy, and a friendly format, you are going to see people preferring eating out rather than basically cooking in it. So I do believe that this is, you know, we're talking about generational changes. So we've got to look at business and life more in 10-year chunks of time rather than over a 1-year, 2-year, 3-year, 5-year period, because a lot of these kind of businesses will evolve and change over a much longer period of time.
I'll come to the time part soon. So one micro question, Dhanbhat. When you brought in Burger King, did you do some kind of survey to see what is the recall of Burger King in India, or is it because of the generic name Burger? What was the logic?
Very good question, and surprisingly there's not a lot of recall on that name.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I guess a lot of people who travel overseas know it, but we actually did a lot of, I would say, initial testing in what we call the B category cities and C towns, etc. of this. So we went to places like Amritsar and Patna and Madurai and Coimbatore just to try and get a sense. And surprisingly, not a lot of people know it. I mean, you know, frankly speaking, it's not as, you know, obvious as one would think in a city like Bombay. But at the same time, it also means that there's a huge untapped market out there where people, as they discover these kind of, food tastes and these opportunities to dine out and eat in a very friendly and a fun-loving format, I think you basically create a huge blue ocean type of, you know, opportunities for yourself.
Right. So, you know, Dhanbhat, when you think of a brand, you know, does it have to be a national brand? You know, any of you can answer. So I'll just give an example, you know, the biryani that is sold in Delhi is, biryani brand, but in South, you have Ammi's biryani. Right? Now, it's not a national, but it's very tough for Ammi's biryani brand to be sold in Delhi or North India. Right? Or for that matter, you've seen a few Vada Pav brands from Bombay, you know, where the name Vada Pav is attached to the brand. Right? And very difficult for them to stay beyond the region. Right? So how do you, I mean, do you think it's now, because India is a large country, is it possible for somebody to invest in regional space? Or the brand and the product has to be national, you know, right from the word go? Any of you? Anyone? You want to answer?
So, I don't think we are that fussed about whether it's a regional brand or national brand or whether it's a city brand or anything like that. I think the key is whenever we meet businesses, what we like to understand is, in whatever they're doing, in the place that they're operating, are there enough reasons to believe that the product and the brand association is special? And I think that is way more important than whether it has got, you know, all India presence or all India distribution, or even frankly, doesn't matter if it's in every city or a top 8 cities in India. I think the more important is, for whatever product you're servicing, look, if you're the best Vada Pav, recognized as the best Vada Pav, you're relevant for, you know, 100 million people in Maharashtra, I think that's fantastic, that's great. That's more important than being one more product which is undifferentiated, unknown across the entire country. So I wouldn't say I don't think we view the lens of it as regional or national. The lens that we take is, in the product market that it operates, you know, can you call it a brand? That's the question we like to answer.
I can give a slightly different twist from an entrepreneur's perspective. I think this is a challenge that we see a lot of times, people trying to scale and grow businesses very rapidly. They immediately think about basically going and hitting all the 8 towns, or Bombay, Delhi, Bangalore, Chennai, Calcutta. You know, these are all obvious. It's a very, very flawed strategy. Okay, in fact, sometimes building a regional powerhouse is a lot better than trying to just claim to be a national player. So I would actually play upon local capabilities and local tastes, and actually build, and there is, today the market, I believe, in over 5 years will be even more so, a market where regional players will become larger by themselves. So I think the cluster effect of working in one micro market, building capabilities out there, building penetration, building consumer preferences, it just works a lot better from, at least, you know, trying to basically, these are high cash burn businesses, so you just want to be very, very smart about how you use a capital.
Right.
I just wanted to throw one data point that, you know, the so-called most evolved market in the US, you know, even today has almost 60% of its food coming from small regional brands and local brands and not the MNCs. So, you know, if that market has that, you know, there's no reason why.
A very fair point. Really, even packaged goods. In fact, even groceries are seeing that, you know, there are regional stores for groceries, right? There are like Mangalore stores and Kerala stores and Bengal stores, right? For groceries also. Even unpackaged goods. So, what do you want to say?
And in general, and for services businesses, at least we tell all our companies to just do cluster-based rollout, because you end up dominating the market, you end up driving out competition, you end up, it's just easier to manage from a cost perspective. There are lots of benefits of just doing a cluster-based approach.
So you're saying that, you know, if you plan, if you have money to open 5 outlets, right? Do that, for example, in one suburb of Bombay.
Exactly.
You know,
just dominate
one. Don't like
part.
One in Thane, one in Navi Mumbai, one in Borivali.
Maybe you could. It all depends on what you're trying to sell, right? But you know, just try and know your zone of influence and try and stay within that, because you'll be able to manage costs a lot better.
And I can give an example from another services company, not in food, but Treehouse, right? It's a place, Kulchain, that we've invested in. So they have about 500 centers in the country. More than 200 are only in Maharashtra.
Right.
So that's the level of geographic.
100
in Bombay.
Yeah. No, I think that's the point, data point that we've seen in Faso. Boston
healthcare is more prominent in South.
Same.
Fair point. So, you know, if you can talk about a time horizon, there was a question in the previous panel about, you know, these things take food in a slow business, right? I mean, in general. Right? I mean, it takes, like you say, if it's about changing tastes of people, it's about taking for people to adopt hectic beverages over, like, you know, a homemade ampana. How do you view this as an exit opportunity? You know, is it like, do you ask the entrepreneur to prove an exit option after 5 years, 10 years? How does it work? Or do you say, you know what, it's okay, this is like a very long business, let's not worry about exits today?
I think we are venture investors, therefore we understand really early in life that everything takes time. It's not just food, it could be a technology business, it could be a retail healthcare business. You know, all of them take time in India, and not just in India, probably everywhere in the world. And I think, of course, some of them hit an inflection and find it easier to scale. Of course, even in this, you know, between a delivery food services versus packaged food, you know, there are some businesses that are easier to scale intrinsically just because of how they're built. You know, sales and distribution businesses are and do find it fastest to scale than retail businesses. And I think the key for any investor, and that's what we keep telling ourselves, is you must understand the nature of the business and therefore have reasonable expectations in terms of how that can ramp up. The answer will be different for every type of business. One, because of the business model, and second, of course, is market size as well, because some businesses may be more constrained by market size versus some, you know, where, you know, it could just be a very, very, very large market. So I think the market size is one side and the other side is the nature of the business. So with these two things in mind is how we think about, you know, investing. And in terms of duration, I think as venture investors, I think if you look at our own portfolio in India, which we have been investing over the last 8 years, and the reality is average hold period is probably 8 years. So and that's how long it takes. You know, a couple of business cycles and a couple of ups and downs before you get to a place where you can even think about, you know, a genuine exit.
So another question I have is that, you know, as we see Flipkart and, you know, Snapdeal and, you know, all of these companies skyrocketing in valuation, a typical food entrepreneur will say, you know what, I work much harder. This food is a much harder business, breaks your back, it's not in air-conditioned offices, right? And dealing with much tougher category of employees, right? You know, do you really think there are some things which will make a food startup as sexy as e-commerce for any of you? Any tips or suggestions for entrepreneurs? No? Because how do we make food as attractive for investors?
I think food is pretty attractive, period. So I would not even think of contrasting ourselves with other businesses, right? I'm saying, one has to take a little bit of a philosophical approach in life to these things, right? I'm saying there was a time when, you know, every land developer was probably getting valued at astronomical levels. And then, you know, you can't sit and say, oh, real estate is so hot, so let me start a business in real estate. You know, there was a time when it felt like building roads or building power plants was the, you know, surest path to prosperity. You know, sometimes it may feel like e-commerce and tomorrow it may be food. I don't think, at least as investors and then as we meet entrepreneurs, I think it's very clear to us that the companies that are truly enduring, that last a long period of time and become bigger, are those where the entrepreneur is passionate about what he's doing, and that could be making chips, or it could be making a beverage, or it could be, you know, rolling out a food service. Ultimately, it has to be linked to who you are and what you're doing. I don't think it makes sense for any of us, definitely for investors, to get carried away by, you know, what is the flavor of the month, because we all know that flavor of the month keeps changing.
You know, but just to add to what you said, I think there are some fundamental challenges in the food business, and one of the things that we see, if you just broadly look at the consumer space, consumer products, whether it be FMCG products or other types of products, the gross margins in those business are significantly high. Okay, so there's a huge kind of a, I would say, buffer between the cost of goods and what price you sell to do a lot of things to actually create brands which are sticky over the long term. The food business does not give you that much luxury. So by and large, your gross margin in the food business will be possibly half of what you would see in the consumer products business. And therefore, what you have to play with is that much more slimmer in terms of all your branding activities, distribution activities, to make sure that your product actually is there and you can sell and you can actually generate revenues. The converse of that is that if you are successful, you tend to get much, much better valuations in that space, right? So I think what Vini said, the journey is possibly tougher, but the outcome, the rewards are therefore that much more sweeter at the end of the day. It's not easy. We've actually built packaged foods businesses, we've built, you know, food retail businesses, we've built food service companies. It's not easy, but getting there, we can tell you that there's a lot of value.
I agree. I think these are very sticky brands and not that vulnerable to competition or discounting for that matter. People are not going to shift from their pizza brand because somebody else is giving discounts on a different pizza.
There's not enough margin between a commodity play and a brand play for people to want to shift.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I think very valid point. If we can talk about, team compositions, right? I mean, what is important, you know, and all of you may have different approaches. So, you know, do you value existing, let's say, a family-run business which has a professional team, or is it just about the entrepreneur and his personal capability? In technology, we have a rule, sort of, you know, at least two people team, one business guy, one tech guy. So you have any kind of rules for, or there is no rule, and, you know, just about any general guidelines on how to form a team, how to look for a co-founder? Is it important? If it's a very old business, a 10-year-old business, is it important to have a co-founder at all? So some examples.
I'm not sure. I can give you examples. Yeah. That makes it just easier, right? Because I don't think we think so much in terms of rules. You know, two, three things that I can immediately reel off is, if it's, let's say, a sales and distribution business, then absolutely a sales and distribution experience is usually the one. One of the points mentioned in case of Neeraj of Paperboard, again, you know, that 4 years, it may not be a lot of time, but that 4 years spent at Coke was obviously hugely valuable in terms of just understanding how the sales and distribution element worked. So that could be a useful operating skill to have for someone in the team. Actually, but stepping back, I would say the number one thing in food is product. It has to be the person, and that's why it's entrepreneur. We only invest in entrepreneurs. So for us, the entrepreneur must have a distinctive ability to demonstrate why that food is so great. And I think in any product for us that has worked in food, the food tastes good. In a tech product, the product should feel good. I think the same thing holds true absolutely in food. The product must taste good, it must resonate with what the consumer wants. There is no substitute to getting a good product. Now that can come from years of experience, of just having been in the business, 8-10 years, zero understanding of, like one of our investors, a snack company, you know, he was an engineer, you know, and he's built a taste in food over 10 years.
But some people may be out of, you know, food technologists, some people may have someone in the family. So I think the source can be different. It can be the fact that you had a family business, it can be the fact that you understand technology. But I think the core, it has to be, the taste is very critical. So I would say number one, taste. Number two, if it is a sales and distribution business, obviously someone with that experience. If it's a retail business, then someone with operating experience. Because retail is all execution, front-end execution, damn hard to do, but you need someone like that. So I would say, depending upon the business model, the second experience varies, but taste is paramount.
That's what I see.
Devesh, you have something to add to that?
One difference here is that we are a small cap buyout fund. So many times the entrepreneur is no longer actually in the business.
Oh.
So, but at the same time, someone has to run the business. So, you know, the skills which we look for very clearly, you know, as we're sharing, you know, if it's a packaged business, sales and distribution extremely key, because, you know, if, you know, and as I shared, team being that, you know, from kitchen to loose to shop, so you got to be at the shop. You know, if you are at the shop and you're always available, then you get sold. And therefore, sales distribution is key, but there are allied functions depending on what you want, whether you want have a outsourced manufacturing business or you have a product development requirement. So you need to have an ecosystem, but primarily would be sales distribution.
In very similar to what VT said, early stage, obviously you have to just go back the entrepreneurs. You can't do anything beyond that on backing the team, right? So again, but depends on the model that you have. So if it's a food tech kind of a setup, like some of the business models that we saw, obviously you would want the co-founder to have a lot of tech experience, right? So if it's a food marketplace or any of those kind of ones. If it's food services, then we would actually like to see the guy who can actually get his hands dirty and run a very tight ship, right? Because as Lampal said, it's a very, you need to control those costs to the last level, right? So, we don't need an IITian, we don't need somebody who's, you know, great at marketing, we need somebody who can run a very tight ship. And because ultimately that's what's going to come.
So Tenpal, Everspose model is slightly more unique in the sense that you have a lot of operating relationship with the company. And for you, is it, again, I mean, is it okay to not have the original entrepreneur continuing, you know, to manage the company? Is it okay if somebody says that I have a professional management, you can bring in your management, how does it work?
So there is that whole, what we call platform investing that we do, where we actually build businesses and teams from scratch.
Okay.
So it's then, you know, a little bit differentiated from the form that we are actually putting. One, differentiating ourselves with either a brand like a BK being brought into India.
Mm-hmm.
So you get a lot of systems, processes, all the practices, you know, that they have basically followed elsewhere in the world and localize it to their Indian construct. Two is, you basically also, because you're putting a significant amount of capital to work, you're able to hire the best teams, right? So the biggest challenge in any startup is that basically you can't pay, right? Because you're bootstrapped, you basically can't hire quality talent. And that's what a little bit, you know, I would say, putting a lot of capital to try and build a very scalable business in a short period of time gives you the luxury, the ability to go out and actually hire the best professionals and bring them into the business to build it out. So that's a kind of a different, I would say, construct and a model. But coming back, I think the challenge of an entrepreneur really is, you know, figuring out, because in most situations like this, you have to build teams which are complementary to you and not just doing what you're already doing. So figure out what you don't do well and try and find team members and players and partners who are actually going to kind of make sure that those aspects of your, you know, capability which are not there, where you particularly weak on, whether it be a functional area or whether it be a market area, just get those members in.
Got
and then figure out you want to be them partners, employees, or advisors. That's also very important.
I think we're ready to take some questions. Yeah, Hitesh.
Okay. So, would I be wrong to say if I look at the QSR segment in this country, we have a lot of multinational chains looking at India. A couple of them are there, the McDonald's, Burger King are there. Would an Indian QSR chain actually succeed in the future? Because if you look at comparison, you've got the international chains coming in with deeper pockets, with systems, with the ability to scale up really, really fast. Vis-a-vis an Indian QSR who's starting, and I see a lot of friends and fellows making the mistake of trying to get into international cuisine. So you've got sandwiches, burgers. Indian chains try to do what international chains are doing. But if I look at history, the ones that have been funded in the past, from Ammi's Biryani to maybe the Faso's and Musk Kalandar, are all focusing more on the local Indian cuisine, the regional cuisines. Because as a food entrepreneur, if I look at the restaurant space, the QSR space clearly to me seems the large players international. The restaurant space is very, the compliances are crazy. I have to put a lot of capex upfront to build that space. Typically, if you see the trend in that space, I've seen a lot of, it's like construction. There are first, second generation of businesses, their children are running the businesses right now. A lot of those chains, restaurants are being built by their fathers who had started a restaurant and now scaling up. But would I be wrong to say, if this is where the two businesses are, where does an Indian food player try to fit in the food retail space?
Look, again, it goes back to what is it that you want to offer, right? I think consumers today are willing to vote with their feet if they don't like the product, right? They're willing to walk out, they're willing not to come back, and they're willing to basically, just not patronize any particular establishment. So the key is that do you have something with you which not only can you attract consumers with, but where you believe that the entire backend is there to support your entire operation. Because QSR, you must understand, is one about replication to create scale. Your ability to replicate and create scale is fundamentally dependent on two things. Real estate and your entire supply chain. Okay, everything else in between is just process to make sure that you deliver something to the consumer. And both these elements in India, today, more than ever, the QSR industry has, think about where McDonald's was 15 years ago and where it is today. So I think what you will see, there is a whole host of players within this entire food chain which are created, building capacity, supporting to build and support the entire QSR industry. So I do believe whoever starts today is not starting with any kind of competitive disadvantage, and for the next 10 years will continue to feed into a marketplace which will grow, I think, maybe at least 20 times to 30 times to the industry.
So, Hitesh, I want Gigi to support me. I think the biggest QSR players in India, for example, are people like Hathiram, right? And they're Indian taste. So I don't think that McDonald's or Domino's are anywhere comparable to Hathiram. They are way bigger than most of these guys. They're across the spectrum. It's not just one format that they have, even FMCG. So, Gigi, do you really think that it's only about the international players?
No, I certainly think that's not going to be the case. Food is a very cultural product, and then you go back to your own self and you look at how much of your food is Indian, quasi-Indian, Indian-like, and then you say what is truly, truly international. You'll be shocked at how much proportion is truly, truly international. So I think the advantage international chains have, as Dhanpal said, is you have systems, you have processes, you have to figure out the product. That's as big a challenge for the international guy as for the Indian guy. I'm saying, what is the product reality? Look, the McDonald's core product is not sold in India, right? I'm saying, if you think about it, that's what they had to reinvent in terms of the chicken burger and the tikka burger. So I think the food, so having said that, therefore, obviously, if you're an Indian player with Indian roots, it's a very easy and a good place to start by saying, look, I understand the Indian roti, or I understand the Indian biryani, and therefore I can build a business out of that. So I certainly think that therefore you will see lots of players Indianizing and making it more QSR friendly, because Indian cuisine does not lend itself to QSR that easily. So there is some innovation and some thinking that has to happen there, and changing behavior, saying that people have to start expecting that it's okay to see Indian cuisine in this format. But having said that, I think it's always space to have an open mind. For example, like, when we met the entrepreneur, we're not investors there, but we met the entrepreneur of MOD, you didn't even expect to see an Indian. You never thought, why should an Indian based out of Singapore show up in India and build a chain? And there's a good chance that more people think MOD launched is the brand for donuts versus, your Dunkin' Donuts or some of the other guys who have shown up, right? So I think that's also possible, and we must always, keep an open mind to the possibility. But I think certainly if you're an Indian guy and you have Indian roots, thinking about how to take the huge variety in Indian cuisine, making it QSR friendly, I think it's absolutely a nice place to start.
Yes, sir.
Give the mic.
My question is to the panel, actually. So there was a a fun way, right, for e-commerce companies a few years back. And we saw a lot of it actually gave a platform for a lot of entrepreneurs to kind of come and start up something on e-commerce. You think with people like Everstone, doing an investment in Burger King is going to get that food fund in? Can we have that sort of attraction coming in the next 2 years? And my second question is to Sequoia actually. Do you think that is there any macro reforms which is going to like probably have more funds coming in from your LPs into your fund? Are they waiting for some reforms to happen?
The second one is a generalistic question, and we'll pass on that. If you can answer the first one. The first question is,
what's the question specifically in the first one?
Do you see a lot of money coming into Indian food startups, like the way it's happening for e-commerce?
No doubt about it. Yeah. We've already seen that happen, right? So if you look at the number of food formats which have got funded over the last few years, it's possibly been one of the most active spaces within the VC, early growth, whatever industry, right? If you look at any particular sector or subsector. So yes, it's a fact. It will, and I think it will continue to attract a lot more investments as we keep going forward. Like I said, there's enough and more opportunity and space for maybe another 50, 100 brands to come up and create market spaces. Question is how many of them can build the scale, the national footprint. Those are very different and typically challenges which are not necessarily unique to just a food retail business, but any business which is trying to scale up and build, a national business.
Okay, any more questions?
I'll just add to that. Look, I think you must, when you're creating your own brand, it is always a more time consuming effort. And it takes more time, it scales more slowly, but it's more enduring, right? When you're selling other people's brand, you can always grow fast, you can always grow quickly, but it's not clear how enduring that business is. So I think it's very important to recognize that. Having said that, I think Dharpal is absolutely right. You just look at the amount of activity in food and variety of shapes and forms over the last 3 years, it's probably more than apparel, more than probably almost as much as healthcare, and certainly more than pharma. So if you look at the various segments, it's been one of the most busiest space, I would honestly say, in the last 3 years. So,
and there are lots of different sources of capital. It's not just organized institutional capital which is chasing it. So a lot, we constantly see families, family offices, private investors wanting to get into the space. So you just got to be very entrepreneurial even when you're thinking about your fundraiser. Just don't restrict yourself to the 10, 20, 30 funds which are there.
Very
if I just wanted to add that actually the wave in food must have already happened in that sense that there are already maybe 50 QSR investments. Now I think what's going to happen is there's a second wave. So how many of them will survive, will grow, the promise of 500,000 outlets, have they happened, not happened? So I'm sure guys like you would be saying, hey, these didn't work, what happened? And therefore what can I do so that I do reach that 200, 500 kind of goal, which otherwise remains in Excel spreadsheets.
Yes, sir.
This question goes to, I think, you are favorite. So, retail distribution, e-commerce, what's the priority?
Well, look, our priority is finding exciting entrepreneurs with good ideas. So, if you look at our activity level over the last 2 years, 3 years, I would say we've probably been as busy in sales and distribution focused consumer businesses. Healthcare has been a big focus area for us. And I would say in technology, we've probably been more active on software and payments as opposed to retail. I don't think we've been, we are not big investors in tech-enabled retail or as e-commerce as it is commonly, is popularly known. We're not big investors in that space, and we've not been for the last 5 years. So I would say even in technology, our bias has been more software or tech services, which are like Justdial, like Zomato, which are playing off on different things, not necessarily on commerce, but playing off on different areas. I would say that's been our plan.
One last question. Anybody? Yes.
So I mean, we look at various strategic tie-ups when you build a business going forward, and the same is what you look from, when you look at the VCs or the angels, you typically look at what kind of synergies are they going to bring. So is it the other way around as well with the VC, like when you look at investing into ventures, do you look at is it bringing synergies into various investments that you have otherwise done, and does that add value or points to, would you invest into that venture or no?
From a portfolio perspective, maybe.
I think it certainly adds value to you.
Okay.
If you have someone who's done something like
yeah.
this before. Now, I think is there, I would say synergy is the way we try to organize ourselves, that's probably true for every fund here, is we do try to focus on sectors so that we build knowledge at least a little about, you know, the space that we are focused on, right? I'm saying you're the experts, you're the people who are building business in the area. There will certainly be no one who knows that space more than you. But at least by trying to invest in similar businesses, we try to build some pattern recognition, some knowledge that is hopefully useful for you. So the purpose, the reason why we focus is so that we can be more useful for you. At least that's the way I see it.
Okay, you have to
The entire panel actually. You, all of you have invested in food businesses. I'm sure you burnt your fingers. So as an advice to people who are in this business, can you tell us some of the pitfalls which we could avoid? Because I'm sure you've learned over the period of where we go wrong, as in scaling, in Excel sheets. So where is it that, you know, typically a food entrepreneur makes mistakes?
One thing is that, you know, if you try to think that if somebody was not able to do this,
hello,
but I'll do it better, right? You're not doing enough homework. So one big problem is that people think, oh, that's not a problem. If I simply got 2 crore rupees to market, I'll make my restaurant work well, right? So I think you can't say the food has to be good. It has to be so good that it doesn't require any marketing. And so it boils down about the product. And I've seen very interestingly, you know, people start a chain or any business, the food doesn't taste good. It's a very elementary mistake. I mean, don't put enough homework in designing the right menu, getting the right chef, getting the right taste out, or consistency for them.
So I'll add a few more learnings. Marketing never solves a business problem.
Yeah.
So if the business is not working, don't blame it on lack of ad dollars. In retail, I think Dhanpal already made the point, cluster is the only way to go. Fragmenting yourself across multiple places is bad. In sales and distribution business, you know, making sure that you dominate a category in a market way more valuable than spreading yourselves thin. And in sales and distribution businesses, you know, we have made mistakes, entrepreneurs have made mistakes about, you know, that's where inventory, channel, receivable, etc. all become very important. I think
choose your channel in sales and distribution. Most
yeah.
people tend to try and spread too wide across too many channels and just kill their business model. Inventory is lying out there, not getting sold, lots of things happening. So just focus on that.
I'll just add one thing. Get your model right, especially in a services business. Get the core model right.
Unit
economics. And then scale it.
Unit model, get it right.
Till you get it right, just don't
spend enough person. Time on getting the unit model right. Sorry guys, I can't take any more questions. We have Rajat from Matrix. They do early stage, more tech investments. VT of Sequoia doing multi-stage. Dirmesh doing buyout and lead stage. And Dhanpal is like the god of Burger King. So Dhanpal, by the way, is also president of TIE, and it's been a privilege to work with Dhanpa. We hope to do, please give us suggestions on what we can do for TIE. We are all available on platforms. You know, if you want Dhanpa to do something special for all of you, we'll be very happy to. also,
except for cold.
So, no, I think it's good to have Dhanpa. He's been very active and new lease of life. I mean, if you can give a big round of applause to...